Hello, everybody. So welcome and good morning or good afternoon. So our speaker today will be Kazuya Unikura. He will tell us about classification of topologically non-trivial terms in action. I also realized that now it's a bit 4 minutes earlier than the schedule. So shall we wait for 4 minutes until 8? Sorry. Okay. So
most people will probably connect it at one.
Yeah, yes, exactly. So Kazuya, do you want to test your audio also?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
That's great. Okay, so let's maybe wait for 3 more minutes for more people to come. Okay, maybe let's start today's program. So the first speaker today will be Kazuya Unikura. She will tell us about classification of topologically non-trivial terms in action. Let's welcome Kazuya.
Okay, so thank you very much. And first of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this workshop. So in this talk, I'd like to talk about this classification of topologically non-trivial terms in action. And before starting the main part of the talk, first let me comment on the talk itself. So my talk is basically a review of physics motivation of our paper, this paper, Differential Models for the Anderson Dual to Bodhism Theories and Invertible QFTs. This is a collaboration with Mayuko Yamashita, and she's one of the speakers of this workshop. And also, I put here V2 because in version 2, we significantly changed the content of this paper. We improved the proofs, and we also included some new results. However, this talk is just about physics motivations. And in Mike Yamashita's talk, she will talk about the mathematical side of the story and also more developments by herself. And also, let me mention two related papers. So the basic motivation of our paper comes from this paper by Fried Hopkins about the classification of invertible phases. And also, we are also motivated by this paper of Lee and Omori and Tashikawa. Okay, so let me start my talk. So we want to classify actions of quantum field theory. So we consider some field, I denote the field by phi, and we consider action. And I work in the Euclidean signature. So we go from Lorentz signature to Euclidean signature by weak rotation. And this Lorentz signature action is real for unitarity, but this Euclidean action contains the real part and imaginary part. And here, this 2 pi is just my convention, but the important point is that this Euclidean action contains imaginary part. And then we want to know topologically non-trivial terms in this imaginary part of the Euclidean action. So first, let me discuss some basic properties of this imaginary part. So first of all, this imaginary part takes values not necessarily in the real numbers, but in R over Z. And the reason is simply that this action appears in the path integral as exponential of 2 pi I times this imaginary part. So, so the change of this imaginary part by integer is irrelevant. So basically by this reason, this imaginary part is regarded as taking values in R over Z. So this is a very famous fact. And to discuss other properties, let me neglect topological subtleties for the time being. And so for the time being, let me assume that this S is an integral of a local functional, a local function. So this L is the Lagrangian. Then the procedure of going from Lorentzian signature to Euclidean signature is weak rotation of time coordinate. So we pick up some time coordinate, and then we change this time coordinate to minus I times Euclidean coordinate. And under this weak rotation, the volume form changes like this. So it also picks up minus I. And as I mentioned before, this Lorentzian action goes to this Euclidean action with real and imaginary part. And then this Lagrangian also goes to real part and imaginary part. And this behavior under weak rotation implies that this real part contains even numbers of time components. Then such terms goes to real part of this Lagrangian. And this imaginary part must contain odd numbers of time component because it must be multiplied by this I, imaginary unit. And more generally, under reflection of this coordinate, x0 to minus x0, this Euclidean action goes to the complex conjugate. And this property is called reflection positivity. So under the assumption of reflection positivity, so this imaginary part must contain odd numbers of time components. So let me just give some example. So in, for example, in four dimensions, with U1 gauge field A and field strength F, we can consider this kind of term by using this totally antisymmetric tensor. And then we can decompose it into components like this. Then this first term contains three time components, three zeros here. And this second term contains a single time component. So anyway, so each term has odd number of X0 components. So So this imaginary part must contain odd numbers of time components. But on the other hand, it must be also Lorentz invariant. And these two facts imply that we need the totally antisymmetric tensor to construct terms in this imaginary part. So neglecting the topological subtleties, they are just described by differential forms. And also, let me next discuss another property. So let's consider the following counting of kind of scaling dimensions. So I assign dimension one to derivatives, and dimension zero to scalars, and dimension one to gauge field, and more generally, as I assign dimension p to p forms. And I mentioned that we need to use this totally antisymmetric tensor to construct this imaginary part. Then this fact implies that the scaling dimension of each term in this imaginary part must be equal to or greater than the space-time dimension. So this D is a space-time dimension. For example, in four dimensions, we have dimension four term and dimension eight term given by this. And terms which have scaling dimension strictly greater than the space-time dimension are not topologically interesting by the following reason. So let's consider the scaling of the metric tensor. So this G mu nu is the metric tensor. And then let's consider multiplying this metric by some positive constant. Then a term in this imaginary part, which has scaling dimension n, behaves in this way. So under the change of the metric by this factor, this term changes by this amount. And if this m, the scaling dimension, is strictly greater than d, then this term disappears in the limit of taking c to infinity. So this limit corresponds to taking the metric to be very large. And in particular, because this term disappears in this limit of large metric, there is no topological structure in such terms. And so there is no quantization condition. So they are not so topologically interesting. So topologically interesting terms may be contained in this limit, which I denote by H. So this H is the terms in the imaginary part of the action, which has precisely the scaling dimension D. And such terms can be extracted by taking this limit. Then our purpose is to classify such H. And there are two main motivations. The first motivation is obvious. So such terms are interesting in the path integrals when we consider integration over this field phi. And another motivation comes from the description of anomalies. So let me review the modern point of view on anomalies. So in the modern point of view, anomalies in D minus one dimensions may be described by actions or what is called invertible field theories in D dimensions up to manifestly gauge invariant local counter terms. So let me explain the meaning of this statement. So we consider some anomalous theory in D minus one dimensions. For example, there can be some chiral fermions. So we consider such theories. And this is anomalous, but we can cancel the anomaly by introducing D dimensional manifold. So we realize this D minus one dimensional space as a boundary of a D dimensional manifold, and we also assume that the field is extended to this higher dimensional manifold. Then we put some topologically non-trivial action in this D dimensions. For example, we can put Chan Simons terms in this bulk. Then the variation with this Chan Simons term and the gauge variation cancels the anomaly of chiral fermion. So this is a famous anomaly inflow mechanism. And in this way, the total system is gauge invariant by anomaly inflow mechanism. And so this system has a very defined partition function which takes values in complex numbers. So the total system is completely gauge invariant, but it may depend on how to take a d-dimensional bulk configuration. So as a bulk d-dimension, we may take some manifold M and field phi, but we may also take another manifold M prime and another field phi prime. And so we have some choice of the extension to the bulk. And I remark that here I'm treating this manifold and the field as background fields. So I'm not doing pass integral over them. So basically, throughout the talk, I treat the fields as background fields, unless otherwise stated. So we have these choices. And the difference of the two choices can be measured by computing the action on this closed manifold. So these manifolds, M and M prime, have the common boundary. And on the boundary, these fields are also the same. So we can glue them together to get the closed manifold. So we get the manifold without boundary. Then the value of the d-dimensional action on this configuration gives the difference between the two choices. And if this action S is zero in the bulk, then the partition function of the combined bulk boundary system does not depend on the choice of the bulk. Then we can consider the partition function as really the partition function of the D minus one dimensional theory, because it does not depend on how to take the bulk. So in this case, there is no anomaly. So this is the modern interpretation of anomaly. So the anomaly is basically described by this bulk action. However, even if this S is non-zero, the theory can be still anomaly free if we can find a manifestly gauge invariant local counterterm in the bulk, such that this sum is zero. And here, this by this manifestly gauge invariant local counterterm, I mean that this local Lagrangian itself is gauge invariant. Then we can freely modify the bulk action by such a counterterm for the purpose of anomaly cancellation. The point is that this integral of this local gauge invariant Lagrangian is gauge invariant even on manifolds with boundaries. So the existence of such a term does not affect anomalies at all. So we can freely put such terms in the bulk. So let me give some examples of such manifestly gauge invariant terms. So this term, this epsilon mu nu rho sigma, f mu nu f rho sigma, this is manifestly gauge invariant in four dimensions. If we do not impose parity or time reversal symmetry, I come back to this point soon. And in this case, this term does not represent an anomaly. On the other hand, this term, epsilon mu nu rho, a mu del nu rho, so this is a Chan Simons term. So this is not gauge invariant in three dimensions. So it represents the anomaly. And so this is a description of integer quantum Hall systems. So in integer quantum Hall systems, there is this kind of chance-time term in the bulk, and we have some H chiral fermions on the boundary. Let me discuss one more example. So again, let's consider this term. Then this is not gauge invariant in four dimensions in the presence of parity or time reversal symmetry. This is simply because this term changes the sign under the parity transformation like this. So this is not gauge invariant. This is not invariant under this parity transformation. And then consequently, a four-dimensional term like this, so this term is a theta term at theta equal pi. So this term represents a non-trivial anomaly in three dimensions. And actually, this is an effective description of topological insulators. So it is well known that this term at theta equal pi is invariant under the time reversal symmetry if we integrate it over closed manifold without a boundary. But in the presence of the boundary, this term is not invariant under the time reversal symmetry. And so this gives an anomaly of the boundary theory. So, so this bulk action describes anomalies. And I mentioned that this bulk Euclidean action contains real part and imaginary part. And I defined H to be the term in the imaginary part, which survives in this limit. And I believe that only this term H can be relevant to anomalies. In other words, other terms, such as the real part and the imaginary part with higher scaling dimensions can be canceled by manifestly gauge invariant local counterterms. I don't know the proof of this statement, but this is what I believe. And this H itself can be still modified by local counterterms like this one in the absence of parity symmetry. Okay, now let me give various examples of topologically non-trivial terms. So this H is a function which assigns to each pair of manifold and field on the manifold a value in R over Z, so like this. And so now let me give various examples which are very important in physics. The first example is chance-time terms. So maybe this is the most famous example. So we fix some group and we take the field to be the gauge field of this group. Then roughly, or if the if the G bundle is topologically trivial, then this H is given by this expression. Here, for concreteness, I take D equals 3. So this is a famous chance-time term. And here, this K is integer. This is a chance-time level. And C is some normalization constant such that this integral takes values in integers on closed manifolds. So this is a description of chance-time terms. So, and if this M is a boundary of some D plus one dimensional manifold, and if the gauge field is also extended to this D plus one dimensional manifold, then the value of H on such a boundary can be written like this. So it can be given by some integral of a gauge invariant local quantity over this higher dimensional manifold N. So in physics literatures, this is often taken as the definition of Chan-Simons terms. But even if this G is a discrete group, or even if this level K is zero, we can still have non-trivial values for H, which is characterized by a group cohomology. So such H is explicitly described by Dijkhoff and Witten. I don't explain the details, but in that case, this H has the property that its value evaluated on manifolds realized as a boundary is zero. But this H can be still non-trivial. Another example is Bessel-Newton terms. Here, just for concreteness, I take the target space to be a group. And then the field is a function from the manifold M to the sigma model target space. And if this M can be realized as a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, and if this function G is also extended to this higher dimensional manifold, then Bessel-Newton term can be written like this way. So here, for concreteness, I took D equal 4 and D plus 1 equal 5. And here again, this K is a level. So this is an integer. And this C is a normalization constant such that this integral takes values in integers if we integrate over closed manifolds. So this is the standard description of Bessel-Newton terms. And so this description is valid only if this M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold. But if this M is not a boundary of a D plus one dimensional manifold, then we need more data to specify this this value of H. So it can happen that there exists another H prime, which also satisfies this equation if this M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold. Then in such a case, the difference between this H prime and H satisfies this condition. So this condition means that this difference, this H tilde, is zero if it is evaluated on manifolds which are realized as a boundary. And such different H and H prime really appears in actual gauge theories. Or more concretely, if we consider some higher dimensional, if we consider four dimensional gauge theory with SON gauge group, then in low energy, we have chiral symmetry breaking, and then we get Goldstone bosons of chiral symmetry breaking, and we have Bessel-Newton terms. But depending on the details of the UV theory, we get different Bessel-Newton terms in the IR theory. So that can really happen. Okay, next example is a topological non-trivial term in coupling constant space. In this case, I take the field to be a pair. This A is a U1 gauge field. This need not be U1, but for concreteness, I take U1. And this theta is, this is again a sigma model. Well, this is a scalar field. So this is a map from the manifold to S1. So this is a periodic scalar field with period 2 pi. Then we can consider this kind of term. And here, for concreteness, I take D equal 2. So this is a this is basically a theta term for this gauge field of F. And if this theta is a constant parameter, then this is just an integral over manifestly Kenji invariant local term. But we can promote this theta term to a field. Then if we promote this theta to a field, it is not manifestly gauge invariant because this theta and the theta plus 2 pi should be identified, but this theta times f is not invariant under this shift. So this is not manifestly invariant. In this case, we can define a gauge invariant field strength, which I denote by this small f. So this is a exterior derivative of this theta. And this is a one form on S1. And this represents a non-trivial drum cohomology class on S1. So we can consider this f, which represents non-trivial drum cohomology class. And if this manifold M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, then we can write this H in this way as an integral of a local quantity, which is a gauge invariant. And this, so this local quantity has a property that its integral takes values in integers if we integrate over closed manifolds. So this kind of term is important for describing anomalies of space of coupling constants. And here, coupling constant is the theta parameter in this case. I don't talk about the detail of this, but this kind of anomalies are described, for example, by this paper. Okay. Another example is APS get invariant. So in this case, we fix some group. This group may be empty, but anyway, so let's take some group. And then as a field, I take the metric tensor and the gauge field. Then we can consider the Dirac operator, which is coupled to this gauge field in some representation. Then we can consider the Atiyah-Patterson-Singer get invariant of this Dirac operator. I don't describe the definition of this APS get invariant, but it is known that this APS get invariant is very important for describing non-perturbative anomalies of fermions. So non-perturbative anomalies are described by this get invariant. So I take this H to be this yet invariant mod Z. So fermion anomalies are described by this. And if this manifold M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, then there is an APS index theorem, which is given by this formula. So this left-hand side is the index of the Dirac operator in the higher dimensional manifold N. And this index is given by the integral of this characteristic class over N plus this yet invariant defined on the boundary. So if there is no boundary, then this is a Atiyah-Singer index theorem. So index equals the integral of the characteristic class. But in the presence of the boundary, there's a correction term, which is given by this yet invariant. So this is a statement of this APS index theorem. And because of this index integers, for M, which is realized as a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, the value of this H is given by the integral of the characteristic class over this N. So this H is basically this yet invariant, and this yet invariant is equal to this integral, integral of the characteristic class up to integers. So again, this H is given by some integral of gauge invariant quantity. And in particular, if this characteristic class is zero, then this H has this property. And in this case, it describes global anomalies of fermions. And finally, let me give one more example, which which is sigma model anomalies. So in this case, we take some target space. So this X is some target space of a sigma model. So this can be an arbitrary manifold. And I take a field, which is a map from this N to X. So this is a general sigma model. And for example, if we consider some gauge field on this target space, then we can pull back the gauge field to M by using this F. And we can consider all quantities which are discussed for gauge fields. For example, we can consider Chan-Simons terms or data invariant by using the pullbacks of the gauge field on X. And that describes anomalies of fermions coupled to some sigma models. I mean, so we can couple fermions to sigma model fields by putting back gauge fields on X, and then we couple that gauge field to fermions, and then that fermion has anomalies. So that is the sigma model anomalies. And whether that is topologically non-trivial or not depends on the topology of this X. Okay. So I have discussed many examples. So now let me discuss general structure. So from various examples, the general pattern which is satisfied by a topological non-trivial term is hopefully now clear, and I regard it as an empirical fact in physics. So let me state this general empirical fact. So we are considering this function H, which is a map from this pair of manifold and field to some value in R over Z. And it satisfies the following property. If this M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, then it is given by an integral of some P plus one form. Here, this omega is a gauge invariant closed D plus one form, which is constructed from the field. So this this statement is satisfied by all examples which I discussed. And as far as I know, all the examples in physics satisfy this property. I do not know a complete justification of this property of H. So in our mathematical work, we take this as a starting point. But let me mention some evidence that this is the correct property to impose. So one evidence comes from this locality and gauge invariance. This function H is not necessarily an integral over gauge invariant local term, but its functional derivative is given by some integral over gauge invariant quantity. To see this, we consider this change of this D plus one form under the small change of this field. Then this small change is described by the exterior derivative of some gauge invariant quantity, gauge invariant D form, which is constructed by this phi and this delta phi. Then the small change of H under the change of this field is given by the integral of this chi over this M, this D dimensional manifold. So this is a completely local term, and this is gauge invariant. And so this may be enough to guarantee that the perturbative expansion is local and gauge invariant when we perform path integral over this gauge field, path integral over this field. So here, I didn't perform any explicit gauge fixing or quantization, but at least formally, I believe that this is an enough condition to guarantee locality and gauge invariance. And another evidence, let me discuss the opposite limit that the D plus one form is zero. Then in this case, our condition implies that this H is zero when evaluated on a manifold which is realized as a boundary. And such H is called Bodism invariant. And in the framework of topological quantum field theory, it is known that Bodism invariants and invertible TQFTs are in one-one correspondence up to some real order term, but this is not important for my talk. So basically, Bodism invariants and invertible TQFTs there's one-one correspondence between them. So in TQFT, we have some rigorous axioms. For example, in Fried-Hopkins paper, they considered free extended axioms. And in my paper, I considered some non-extended Atiyah-like axiom. But anyway, so we can set up axioms, and under these axioms, we can really prove this statement. So I believe that in the case of TQFT, the understanding is really complete. Okay, now let me comment on this D plus one form. So in the context of anomalies of D minus one dimensional theories, this D plus one form is called the anomaly polynomial. So please notice the difference of the dimension between this D plus one and D minus one. So the dimension differs by two, and such difference is also well known in the study of perturbative anomalies. So in the description of perturbative anomalies, there's a description by what is called anomaly descent equations. And it is a famous fact that anomalies in perturbative anomalies in D minus one dimension is described by some D plus one form. And this D plus one form omega satisfies this condition. So if we integrate this omega over closed manifold, then it takes values in integers. And the proof is very simple. If we consider a closed manifold, closed D plus one dimensional manifold, then it has no boundary. Then in this situation, we apply our condition. So this H evaluated on empty manifold should be zero. But from our condition, this must be equal to the integral of this omega over n mod z. From this, we conclude that this integral must take values in integers. And this is a famous Dirac argument for quantization. And sum h is given by a manifestly gauge invariant local term like this. So here, this alpha is a gauge invariant D form, which is constructed from this field phi. And this kind of terms are not relevant for anomalies because they can be canceled by local counter terms. So so these terms are given by an integral over manifestly gauge invariant local term over this D dimensional manifold. So example is this FHF in four dimension in the absence of time reversal symmetry. So they are not important for anomalies, And by using Stokes' theorem, the corresponding d plus 1 form is given by the exterior derivative of this alpha. So this is, so if this h is given by such local integral, then this omega is an exact form. Okay, now we consider these pairs, h and omega, which satisfy our condition. And we can define Abelian group structure in the set of such pairs. So we can simply take the sum of two pairs, so h1 omega 1 and h2 omega 2. We can sum these two in the obvious way. For example, the sum of h1 and h2 evaluated on this field is given just by the sum like this. So I hope this is very obvious. And we can also sum this omega. I think this is clear, but let me give one example. If this h1 is given by some Chan Simons term with Chan Simons level k1, and if this h2 is given by the Chan Simons term with Chan Simons level k2, then their sum is given by the Chan Simons term with level k1 plus k2. So the sum of these two pairs corresponds to the sum of the Chan Simons levels k1 and k2. So this is the meaning of this Abelian group structure. So we define an Abelian group. So we denote this Abelian group of pairs by this symbol. So this symbol may look a bit complicated. So let me explain this notation. So this I omega is taken from some symbol in mass literature, and I will come back to this point later. And this dr, which appear here, suggests some analogy with Durham cohomology. So we have so d plus one form and d form, and so actually I will also define another group later, and that definition is very close to the definition of Durham cohomology. And in this notation, there are some important data. First, it contains this G. So this G is a symmetry group which we are interested in. For example, if we are interested in some U1 gauge theory, then this group G contains that U1 gauge group. But this G also contains the information of the Lorentz symmetry group. I will also come back to that point later. And also this X, so here this X is a target space of a sigma model or space of couplings. So this space X is basically the target space of scalar fields. So this G specifies the gauge field, and this X specifies the scalar fields. So we defined this group, and this is the Abelian group of topologically non-trivial terms with symmetry group G and target space X. And we can impose equivalence relation in this Abelian group. So two pairs, this H omega and H prime omega prime, are defined to be equivalent if they are related in this way. So if this H prime, if the difference of the H prime and H is given by an integral of a d-form, gauge invariant d-form, and if this the difference of the omega prime and omega given by the exterior derivative of this alpha, then I define them to be equivalent. Here, this alpha is a manifestly gauge invariant D form, which is constructed from this field. So this is very analogous to the equivalence relation, which is used to define Drum cohomology. So in particular, so this second relation, so this is very similar to the definition, which is used, definition of the equivalence relation, which is used in the definition of the Drum cohomology. So we define equivalence relation in this way. Then we denote the group of equivalence classes by this symbol. So, so this right-hand side with hat was our previous group. Then I divide it by this equivalence relation. Then I get a new group, and I denote this group without hat. So physically, this is the equivalence. So physically, the equivalence relation by gauge invariant D form means that we just consider these terms up to gauge invariant counter terms in the bulk. So this left hand side, this new group is the group which is important for the classification of anomalies. And let me mention one important property of this group. To state the property, let me introduce the Bodhism homology group of this X. So this is a Bodhism group. And here, in that context, this G is a group for the tangential structure of the manifold, which is considered in the Bodhism theory. I don't explain the details of this point, but anyway, so we consider a Bodhism group. Then this group satisfies the short exact sequence given by this. So in this short exact sequence, this term, I don't explain the details, but this term describes invertible TQFTs up to continuous deformation. Then if we have such invertible TQFTs, we get an element of our group. So this middle term is our group. So that is the meaning of this map from this to this one. And this term, this homomorphism from this Bodhism group in D plus one dimension to Z, to integers, this term describes the anomaly polynomial up to exact forms. So this map is obtained by integration of the D plus one form over D plus one dimensional closed manifolds. Then, by that integration of D plus one form, we get a map from Bodhism group to integers. And the fact that it takes values in integers, I explained that point before. So this is basically a Dirac quantization condition. So our group fits into this short exact sequence. And actually, so this property is one of the important properties of what is called Anderson dual of generalized cohomology theory. So now I can state the result of our paper. So So let me state the result. So one of our main results is that the group, this group, which I have defined, is naturally isomorphic to the group which is known as the Anderson dual of Bodhism theory. So there is a natural equivalence between this our group, or actually this is a functor from the category of manifolds and smooth maps to abelian groups. So this is actually a functor, and this Anderson dual of Bodhism theory is also a functor, and there is a natural equivalence between them. So this is one of our main results. So in this talk, I don't explain the definition of this Anderson dual of Bodhism theory, but it is known to be a generalized cohomology theory. So this right-hand side can be treated by methods in algebraic topology and stable homotopy theory. So by using algebraic topology, we can deduce many properties of this this left-hand side, which is defined in terms of topological non-trivial terms. Okay. So let me describe one example. So let's take this group G to be spin times SU2. Here, this spin is a spin version of Lorentz symmetry. So this spin is just a Lorentz symmetry, basically. And here, this SU2 is an internal symmetry group. So let's consider this group as an example. And also, let's take this X to be just a point for simplicity. So this means that the target space of the sigma model is trivial. So this means that we consider theories which are fermionic and which has SU2 symmetry, and there's no sigma model. And here, this fermionic means that we consider spin manifolds. So this fact that we consider spin manifolds is specified by this Lorentz symmetry group. Okay. Then, there are some well-known results in the literature. So this group, Anderson dual of Bodhism theory, is well-known, at least up to dimension 5. And in dimension 1 and dimension 2, the group is Z2. And this Z2 are described by mod 2 index of spin manifolds. And for this Z2, the SU2 is not important at all. So we can neglect SU2. And this Z2 are described purely gravitationally. And also, let me mention that this D equal 2, this Z2 is what is called Kitaev-Majorana chain in condensed matter physics. So this Z2 is a low energy limit of Kitaev-Majorana chain. And in three dimensions, we have Z cross G. And the interpretation of this Z cross G is that they describe gauge SU2 and gravitational Chan Simons terms with levels specified by these two integers. So this is the meaning of this Z times Z in three dimensions. And in five dimensions, we have Z2. So this Z2 in five dimensions is SU2 discrete theta angle in five dimensions. And such discrete theta angle is often important in the study of five dimensional gauge theories, which appear in string theory. And in the context of four dimensional physics, this Z2 describes the Witten SU2 anomaly in four dimensions. Okay, so let me comment on the literature. So this group, the Anderson dual of Bodhism theory, is conjectured to give the classification of deformation classes of invertible QFTs. So it is conjectured by Fried and Hopkins. So our result might be seen as either evidence for their conjecture, at least our discussion gives a strong physical evidence of their conjecture. Or we may also see it as an evidence that topologically non-trivial terms satisfy this relation. This relation was basically just our assumption, our starting point. But we get this Anderson dual bodhism theory. So I believe that we are going to the right direction. So this property is really satisfied for topological terms in actions which appear in physics. And our result is also anticipated in early work as an interpretation of the Friedl-Hopkins conjecture. And it was discussed by Lee and Omori and Tachikawa. And finally, let me comment on differential cohomology. So I mentioned that this Anderson dual of Bodhism theory is a generalized cohomology theory. And our group with HAT here, so this group is actually a new model for differential cohomology theory associated to this cohomology theory. And our model is based on differential character, and it has a very natural motivations from physics. And differential cohomology theory seems to be an important language to describe many phenomena, many topological phenomena in physics. And our differential cohomology group is very well suited for the study of such phenomena. Okay, now let me summarize my talk. So topologically non-trivial terms in actions are functions like this, which assigns the values in R over Z to each pair of manifold and field. And if this manifold M is a boundary of a higher dimensional manifold, then the value of H is given by an integral of some gauge invariant closed form, which is constructed from the field. And the terms satisfying this condition up to manifestly gauge invariant local counter terms are classified by the Anderson dual to Bodhism theory. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for this very wonderful talk. So is there any questions? I see one from Celso, so please feel free to unmute and ask a question.